Making headline, 6 p.m. curfew hits a major snag in Provo as traffic piled up. A decision will soon be made on the future of the corruption trial. And the Bahamas and TCI maintain their strong relations. Hey there, Turks and Caicos, I am Delana Alt with your Wednesday, February 10th edition of Newswatch. The news starts now. It seems the new 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. curfew did not run as smoothly as the others. Well, after 6 p.m. on Tuesday evening, motorists were still scurrying to get home, but were unable to do so before the curfew as they were stuck in traffic.
Tuesday saw the beginning of the new 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. curfew, and while most businesses were in compliance and able to close around 5 p.m., we can't say the same for motorists who were stuck in traffic almost an hour after curfew begun at 6 p.m. This is a video Newswatch received of the line of traffic backed up for miles going into downtown Providenciales, which made it that more difficult for persons to arrive home in time for the beginning of curfew. Minister of Health Honorable Edwin Oswood says he is aware of the shortfalls that occurred on Tuesday and says that it also shows that persons are taking curfew very seriously in trying to make it in on time.
We thought that 6 o'clock would have been an acceptable time for the general public because you could have leave work at 5 o'clock and be home within 1 hour. However, we've seen from yesterday that 1 hour somehow isn't enough for persons to leave their work in Providenciales and reach home. You know, I was surprised about that. You know, I don't know what added to that. If it is causing a problem, we have to see how we can adjust and if any adjustments can be made within the week.
The minister says certainly the new curfew shows to be a better alternative to lockdown, and officials highly consider the social and financial implications of a full lockdown, but are prepared to make the leap if crucially necessary.
The whole thing is to try and have a balance. Alternative was to lock down the whole country and persons out 1 hour per day, like how most countries are doing, the UK and certainly a lot of our Caribbean neighbors. It is to protect the businesses. We didn't want to close the whole country and close down businesses and be too hard. That is the best thing to do for health. If we really, really want to really stop the possibility of COVID spreading from one person to the next, it's a full lockdown. We know that will be most effective, but however, the social implications of that, the business implications, the economic implications, you know, you're going to be saving them on one end and killing them on the next. And we, as a government, has always committed to try and find a balance.
Businesses are also encouraged to use their own discretions.
If you know your employees having problems, go home. You can let a first set of employees to knock off half an hour early if they cannot make it home within the hour's time.
The 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. curfew was set for February 9th through 16th.
A quick commercial break now, but do stay with us.
This is a reminder that all PTV service accounts are due on the first day of each month. Accounts should be brought up to date by the 28th of the month to avoid disruption in service. Payments may be made on our office at Stubbs Diamond Plaza, Providenciales, Mides Plaza, North Caicos, and Airport Road in South Caicos. Payments may also be made online using Scotiabank, CIBC First Caribbean Bank, and Royal Bank of Canada. Please allow 3 business days for online payments to be processed. We thank you for your cooperation.
Welcome back to Newswatch. A decision will soon be made in the Special Investigation and Prosecution Team trial. This is according to the Office of the Director of Public Prosecutions. In a joint statement Monday afternoon, the Director of Public Prosecutions and members of the Special Investigation and Prosecution Team, SIPT, extended their condolences to the family of the late Justice Paul Harrison following his sudden passing. The statement reads, quote, "An immensely wise, patient, and focused jurist, whose legal rulings will no doubt be of guidance and assistance to the judiciary for years to come. No lawyer who appeared before me, Mr. Justice Harrison, could fail to have recognized his inexhaustible patience, kindness, compassion, and concern for all involved in the process. A man of gargantuan integrity and moral fiber. End quote. Meanwhile, there still has been no decision on the future of the corruption trial. However, one is promised soon. The office of the DPP, which has oversight of the prosecutorial process in the Turks and Caicos Islands, will be making that decision. Upon consideration of all the appropriate and relevant factors, the public will be informed if the $100 million trial will continue with a new judge or will be scrapped. The 85-year-old Justice Harrison passed away after a short illness in Jamaica this past Sunday, February 7th. This coming Monday, February 15th, the case will reconvene. It is expected that at that time, motions and other arguments related to the future of the trial will be presented to Madam Chief Justice. Purchase of shares in the First Caribbean International Bank Limited by GNB Financial Group will not proceed as expected. Latoya Walken with the details in this next story.
Canadian Imperial Bank of Commerce said its planned $797 million sale of a stake in its Caribbean unit won't proceed after regulators rejected the deal, leaving the bank stuck with a business that had been declining in value. CIBC announced the sale of the two-thirds stake in CIBC's First Caribbean to a company run by Colombian billionaire Jimmy Jelinski in November 2019. The deal, which would have left CIBC with a 25% stake in the Barbados-based bank, valued the First Caribbean at about $1.2 billion, less than half of its $2.8 billion value when CIBC took over most of the business. CEO of First Caribbean, Colette Delaney, stated, quote, "While this transaction would have supported First Caribbean's long-term growth prospects, it is only one way of supporting growth for our bank going forward. CIBC has held a majority ownership stake in First Caribbean for a number of years, and there exists an excellent working relationship with a shared focus on meeting the needs of our clients." The CEO further stated, quote, "First Caribbean is a strong, well-run bank which is adjusting sensibly to the economic reality of the pandemic and is well positioned to recover as the economies of the region recover. We remain laser focused on delivering our strategy, providing our clients with first-class service through a modern everyday banking experience, and providing our employees with the best possible work experience." End quote. According to the Globe and online publication, an internal memo to the staff noted, quote, "Much has changed since the transaction was originally proposed, and with uncertainty around the speed of the economic recovery, the regulators are cognizant of the systemic importance of First Caribbean and the role it plays in the region." End quote. Now, you may recall that when the Bank of Nova Scotia sold its operations in several smaller Caribbean countries, the bank encountered pushback from the local government in Antigua and Barbuda and had a part of the deal turned down by Guyana's Central Bank. In late 2019, Royal Bank of Canada sidestepped similar headaches by selling its Eastern Caribbean operations to a consortium of local banks. CIBC has made multiple attempts to exit the Caribbean or to start reducing its ownership, but all have fallen through. Notably, the bank attempted to list First Caribbean on U.S. stock markets in 2018, looking to raise as much as $240 million by offering 9.6 million shares, but failed to garner enough support from its investors. First Caribbean employs about 2,900 people in 64 branches and offices across 16 countries, including Barbados, the Bahamas, the Cayman Islands, and the Turks and Caicos Islands. Reporting for PTV News Watch, I'm Latoya Walken.
A break now, but the weather is up when we come back.
In order to auto-scan your PTV set-top box, you need to follow these basic steps. Turn on your television and set-top box. Press menu on the remote control. Choose installation and press OK. Enter password, press 0000. Choose auto search and press OK. Go down to start search and press OK. Choose yes and press OK. The box will start searching for channels until process bar reaches 100%. Click on exit and data will be saved. Click on exit again to continue enjoying the PTV experience. Thank you for supporting the PTV network.
A mixed weather pattern across the island. Here's your weather forecast for Thursday, February 11th. On Grand Turk, a few clouds from time to time. High 78, low 74. Winds northeast at 15 to 25 miles per hour. South Caicos, mostly cloudy skies. High 78, low 73. Winds northeast at 15 to 25 miles per hour. North and Middle Caicos, partly cloudy skies. High 77, low 72. Winds northeast at 15 to 25 miles per hour. Part and Pine Key, partly cloudy skies. High 78, low 72. Winds northeast at 15 to 25 miles per hour. A look now at Providence Yawlies, partly cloudy skies. High 78, low 72. Winds northeast at 15 to 25 miles per hour. Let's look at your sunrise and sunset for tomorrow. Sunrise 6:23 a.m. Sunset 5:45 p.m. High tide and low tide now. High tide 7:19 a.m. 7:44 p.m. Low tide 12:59 a.m. 1:40 p.m. And that's it for your weather forecast. So we'll be right back with more on Newswatch.
This is a reminder that all PTV service accounts are due on the first day of each month. Accounts should be brought up to date by the 28th of the month to avoid disruption in service. Payments may be made on our office at Stubbs Diamond Plaza, Providence Jollies, Mides Plaza, North Caicos, and Airport Road in South Caicos. Payments may also be made online using Scotiabank, CIBC First Caribbean Bank, and Royal Bank of Canada. Please allow 3 business days for online payments to be processed. We thank you for your cooperation.
Welcome back to Newswatch. An appeal has been made to members of the public when they are out partying to cooperate with the police officers as they work to control the spread of COVID-19 in the islands. Sergeant Clark remembers one of his fellow officers who was struck down by COVID in the line of duty.
One night, while I was working at the Grace Bay Police Station, patrolling with my partner, we came to a location where we found two ladies struggling to fix their tire. In fact, they were there pumping air in it, not knowing that the air was coming back out because the tire was burst. My partner, he was excited. He said, "Look, Clark, let's go and help these ladies because they need help." And once we get to the ladies, he came out of the vehicle and he got right into business. He took off his belt so he could feel comfortable to help those ladies. That partner is Officer 329 Balanag. Balanag is not here with us today due to COVID. And every time I think about him, I think about how respectful he was, how he always wanted to help people. And to know that he's not here today, you know, he left his family behind, police officers who loved him. He was a very great man, a very great partner. I want you all to know that COVID is real. There are people who are saying that it's a hoax, it's not true. But you need to ask persons who have lost loved ones due to COVID. Ask them. Our numbers of death in the Turks and Caicos Islands is right here. We are not in any other country. Ask persons right here. Ask them, how do they feel? What was it like? And then you will know whether it's real or not. So we lost our colleague, Mr. Balanag, and it's sad how fast that he was gone just like that due to COVID. I don't know how he got it, but Balanag was a police officer. He was a frontline person who have to deal with people every day.
Police officers and other compliance officers put their lives on the line every day to keep us safe. But as Sergeant Clark explains, it has been very challenging these past several weeks to get residents to comply with the COVID-19 control measures, especially when they are out partying.
So imagine a police officer who have no choice, still have to go there, arrest offenders. We have to deal with persons who refuse to put on masks, who, when they get intoxicated, they don't care. We still have to face them. So ask your families, ask your friends, those persons who are doing their best to protect themselves, still getting sick. We're still losing them.
Clark also gave a rundown of how many tickets police have issued for the month of January to date.
Since January 2021, the compliance team, which Mr. Neely spoke to you about earlier, consists of police officers and public health officials, have issued a total of 56 tickets for persons breaching COVID regulations. 23 of those were for persons who are breaching the curfew since the curfew started. 10 for restrictions of businesses at $5,000. And 23 for persons failing to wear a mask. The compliance team have been out there since last year, working and having to deal with people. We've been giving breaks, we've been giving warnings, we've been educating the public. And as you can hear from Ms. Malcolm, we are now facing a surge and numbers and cases. What more do you want us to do? We have give you all the opportunity to do the right thing. We still have people not doing the right thing. We still have people challenging these officers when they come around.
Sergeant Clark has a few words of advice for persons when they are out and about with friends.
Over the weekend, we had a challenge where someone sitting at a bar, drinking, having a conversation with someone else. And when that person was approached by the officers, the person said they are sitting at a bar drinking. Come on, if you want to help us curb this, do the right thing, although it may not be comfortable. It may not be comfortable to keep your mask on, but that is what the science say, put on your mask. So put it on. Now, if you're sitting at a bar by yourself, you're drinking, I can understand you have the mask below your mouth. But if you're going to sit down at a bar having a conversation with someone else, having a conversation with the bartender, every time you take a sip, put the mask back up and continue your conversation. Don't tell me you're sitting at a bar drinking, therefore you don't have to wear a mask. If you read the regulations did not make that exception. It says, whenever you are in a public place, wear your mask. Protect those that you're speaking with. And if you're whoever you're speaking with, that person should also encourage you to wear a mask as well, because you're not protecting them. Our officers are equipped with body cam. So don't use the excuse that, oh, you're drinking. I can understand if you got to take a sip, you bring the mask down. Once you're done taking that sip, do the right thing and put the mask back up over your mouth to cover the droplets that is coming out because you're having a conversation with someone else.
Residents are reminded that they need to wear their mask at all times when they are out in any public place, unless they are alone and not talking to anyone. The Bahamas names the Turks and Caicos Islands as one of its top supporters in trade during 2019. While the United States remains top, the TCI fell within the country's top three for that year.
2019 was no doubt a difficult year for the Bahamas as the country came face to face with Mother Nature yet again for the second time in 2 years. During this time, the country's Minister of Finance and Trade also worked around the clock securing trades for the chain of islands. Among their list of trading partners, the Turks and Caicos Islands. Newswatch learned that TCI is third on the list of the country's most valuable trading partners, having played a major role in trade during 2019. In second place, Denmark, while the U.S. remains their main source of trade. According to the Bahamas Department of Statistics, in 2018, the Turks and Caicos Islands exported $282,098 worth of goods to the Bahamas, which in 2019 saw a significant increase to $151,894,895 worth of exports to the Bahamas chain of islands. While officials did not list the main items imported, they did reveal that their main commodities were diesel, motor gasoline, prefabricated buildings, and aviation fuel.
That brings us to the end of another newscast. Thank you so much for tuning in. We do appreciate your company. To view more content, visit us at www.ptv8tci.com. Or join us every weekday at 6:30 p.m. I am Delana Owls. See you next time.